Hey everybody, Scott Moore, and it's time again for another episode of the Performance Tour. It's 2024, what's the latest buzz in performance engineering? I'm always asking that question, and that means I have to talk to a lot of people who are also talking to a lot of people asking that very question. What are you working on? And where is performance engineering playing a vital role in what you're doing? And that's what we're gonna discuss, trends in 2024 in performance engineering on today's show. But first, I wanna give a shout out to Tricentis and all of their partners who attended the 2024 Partner Kickoff event in Orlando back in January. We had some great food. I met some new friends and hung out with old ones. Check out these highlights. Okay, let's talk to somebody who's been into performance engineering for decades, who is always talking to companies about, why do you need load testing? Why do you need performance engineering? That takes me to Atlanta, Georgia, where I'm talking to my friend, Mike Staten, about where we are in 2024 and what's coming soon. Mike, welcome to the Performance Tour. Man, it's 2024, it's good to see you. I want you to introduce yourself to our audience, tell us who you are, and how long you've been involved with performance engineering.
Oh man, I'm getting old, Scott. We've been at this for a few minutes. I'm Mike Staten. I started out, I guess, my performance engineering path around 96, 97-ish. It was shortly after the Olympics that I got into the IT world, you know, when the IT boom started hitting. From that point to now, I've been the guy behind the keyboard. I've run performance engineering teams, small teams, enterprise level teams. I've worked with just about every industry that we can think of, especially around the Atlanta area. You know, there are just so many huge companies around here, and the need increased as performance engineering became a hot button. Folks really started, you know, figuring out the value as things broke during Black Fridays and things like that. So it became more of a need than a want as the genre just kind of grew and evolved. So was the guy behind the keyboard slinging code for 20, 25 years. Moved into solution architect, kind of got tired of delivery, services delivery and stuff. And from the solution architect role, moved into sales. So now I'm selling, you know, not just, you know, performance engineering products, but anything really in that application delivery management space.
So things have really changed, but even more so recently in just the last couple of years. And on today's episode, I really want to focus on the trends that we are seeing. First thing would be, what's like the number one change in conversation that you're seeing when it comes around performance, the whys, and what they're trying, the problem they're trying to solve?
Well, in general, you know, the scalability, the performance issues of applications is always sort of, you know, that first go-to, but As DevOps kind of hit, as that agile movement kind of hit, you saw lots of these DevOps teams run out and grab everything they could off the shelf. A couple of years ago, there was a big security breach, the Log4j issues came out. And what we're seeing now is, you know, larger enterprise level organizations are now concerned, right? That Log4j issue was big enough to get the attention of some CISOs. So when a security expert says, what are you guys doing, when they're talking about these, you know, DevOps agile teams, you know, you could have 5 or 6 dozen of these teams running rampant. And all of these guys kind of go grab their own tool sets. You know, it's whatever they're the most comfortable with. And it's great from a productivity standpoint, right? If I know this tool better than any other, why wouldn't I use it? But when you take a look at the security breaches, security risks, that these tools that aren't necessarily enterprise level applications, don't necessarily have the support and the maintenance and all these other things that a larger, more evolved tool has, that becomes an issue, right? Enterprise organizations need to figure out, you know, how do we stay secure? How do we deploy these tools, right? You know, you don't get to run off and just grab something off the internet anymore and you know, right-click, run as administrator and install it. Right. That doesn't happen anymore. Right. So somebody's got to manage these tools. And right after the install, okay, here's install number one. Well, you know, what happens to the next upgrade? What about the updates? So right out of the gate, you know, you've got to figure out how this process works, because you can't have 35 different tools with 35 different processes and expect to be successful. Right. So, you know, that sort of realization has almost shifted back into a COE model in certain instances, where, you know, quality assurance has two parts to it, right? There's quality assurance and quality management. It's that management piece that's failed. So now you're getting, you know, more eyes in this, and folks are starting to standardize again back on smaller tool sets, but flexible enough to do the job that all these other little things do out here. So you need secure, you need flexible, you need manageable. And that seems to be the conversations that I'm in the most right now.
Okay, Mike, you said quality management has failed, not necessarily DevOps has failed, and that's led to a COE model sort of thing. So are you saying that that's coming back as a trend?
I think from an enterprise perspective, and maybe, you know, not necessarily the old school COE that we think about, but you've got to have that big brother. You know, in some form, there's got to be that level of checks and balances to make sure that these, you know, security risks don't run rampant. And again, you've got all these investments, right? Folks are tightening, especially right now, they're tightening their budgets harder than we probably ever seen them in the industry. You know, you take a look out in the world, you know, inflation does affect our, you know, in the software industry, especially around the purchase of tools. So, you know, customers are being pushed to get more bang for their buck and looking at these large technology stacks that may be repeated over and over just because Project A and Project B are doing, they're both testing, right? They're both performance testing, but they're just using different technology stacks. Where can we merge those in order to save money and time, maintenance, lower your security risk, and sort of standardize on a technology?
Efficiencies and saving money, as all these companies have moved to the cloud and they did no optimization, they did very little performance engineering, then they realize it now when they see the bill, it's much larger because of that. I'm sure you're dealing with that, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. When you look at the Amazon or any of the cloud hosts, really, you know, everybody wants to host non-performant applications. You're just throwing money at them.
Yeah.
You know, those CPU cycles, that it looks like they're cheap because they're 0.001 or 3 or 7 cents each, but multiply that across, you know, any Black Friday, and your bill could be in the millions in seconds.
We've talked about that, you know, probably ad nauseum to some people on the show. However, when people move to the cloud, does that mean everything now is HTTP and we can forget about all those legacy protocols we used to work with and load testing tools?
There's so much old school mainframe stuff out there, COBOL. You know, there's always going to be some kind of need of. I think eventually maybe you'll see some of those die off, but I think the tool sets that are in the most demand are the ones that have the most flexibility, right? Yeah. Web's cheap. Everybody can do web. It's those other little gotchas that are hiding behind the couches that really get you, because, you know, the web's your front end. What is it going to talk to? Right. And what's that going to talk to? And what's that going to talk to?
And also the fact that you can't just have a load thrower, right? Everybody can throw load at something. You have to be able to get analysis from that and actionable data from that. So you have to have a product that allows you to do both, whether you're tapping into some external third-party thing or whether it's inherently built into the product. But you've got to, I mean, you as representing now a vendor, Tricentis, who's a maker of this tool, you have to meet the enterprise and you have to meet the level of the smaller companies who maybe all they do have is web. But there are those enterprise customers who still have those bigger needs. There's a need for those protocols still.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, again, regardless of the size of your organization, the more flexible the tool, the more you're going to be ready to adapt to whatever changes come down the pike, right? You could be a little small startup today and get acquired by a larger company, and you're going to be forced to talk to those upstream applications. How are you going to do that, right? Do you want to run out and reinvest your whole architecture, or do you want a tool that's going to be able to pivot with you?
Which goes back to the tool sprawl that you said. If you want to prevent that, start with a product that you can at least expand in these other protocols.
Flexible and scalable.
Yeah.
It's not just your application, right? It's the tools you're using to test your application. That flexible and scalability is the key to success, no matter really where you are in the application delivery management lifecycle.
So what I'm hearing is less tools is better, more centralization or at least oversight happening as
governance,
a trend.
Maybe governance, maybe the other
right,
yeah.
So still a big need for that. But then what about AI and machine learning? How does that play into all this? Because that's a trend everybody's talking about.
Everybody's running down that path, and I don't think we know yet, right? We've got hundreds of companies that are throwing darts at a board, and we don't know what that solution looks like. Everybody's got a little something, And I think in the engineering space, it's going to be ease of use. I think as software development sort of evolves, I think you're going to see AI and machine learning take a bigger part. You know, self-healing scripts. We've got a lot of that now, but we're not at the point yet where you could just walk in a door and say, you know, hey Alexa, write a performance test. But 3-5 years from now, maybe. It could be possible. You know, hey Alexa, you know, deploy 700 load generators to the cloud for me. Who knows? It's in theory, it's doable, but we're just not there yet. But I think you've got so much investment in AI and machine learning that somebody's going to win. What that looks like and how that standardizes across the architecture, the organization, who knows? I don't think anybody's got an answer yet, but there are some really, really slick toys out there right now.
Mike, from the calls that you are having today, as pre-sales, sales, on that side of the fence, how are the conversations changing from years ago as to what people are asking about? Well, how are the questions changing? What are the topics that are changing around load testing and performance specifically?
Probably the hottest topic out there is around mobile devices. We've got, I can't remember the name of the article, but there was an article that came out a year or so ago that they're estimating 75 to 80% of e-commerce is now happening on some kind of device, iPads, iPhones, Google, pick your favorite. So we've over the past 8 weeks, I've had 3 or 4 demo interactive calls around mobile testing. So we see that push, and that's only going to increase. I think the old school days of just sitting around looking at a website and testing it are gone. Even though the technologies are similar, right? We're still looking at web pages, API calls, but how things function on that device and whether or not that device is scalable is a real question, even if it may not be a problem you can solve, right? It may be a manufacturer's issue. But if you can identify the issue, then maybe you can do things with your own app to make it more performant, make it smaller, make it faster, things like that. And then couple of the more interesting use cases we're seeing now are coming out of sort of the warehouse management space. Those little devices by Honeywell and Zebra that track inventory, in giant warehouses to go from A to B. When we test websites and stuff, you and I are used to the e-commerce world, but this is a very different use case where it tracks, all right, you've already bought something from Amazon. How does that thing get to your door? And there are a million little stops that it takes, and there are a million little spots where it's being tracked, and all of that happens on devices.
And that's why the scope of performance continues to stay extremely large. There's no way you can just focus on one area and be a master of all of that. So thanks for being on the show today, Mike.
Brother,
appreciate it.
Fun.
Well, I hope you heard in our conversation, we were all over the board. We talked about AI, mobile, Internet of Things, and how centralization is kind of making a comeback. It's pretty amazing what we're seeing in the market. What do you think? I'd like to hear your feedback. You can always reach out to me at theperformancetour.com. Go to our website, you can send me an email at help@theperformancetour.com. And I'd like to know what you think the performance engineering trends are for this year and over the next couple of years coming. That's this episode of The Performance Tour. I'm Scott Moore. Thank you for watching. I'll see you on the road.